The U.S. and coalition forces have been bombing ISIS targets in Iraq for nearly 2 months now and in Syria for almost 2 weeks. But when it comes to boots on the ground, the Pentagon is talking about sending troops to the Ebola hot zone in Africa, not to the terrorist hot zone in Iraq and Syria. I am joined by two members of the Senate Armed Services Committee, Republican Senator Lindsey Graham of South Carolina and Democratic Senator Jack Reed of Rhode Island. Thank you both for being here. Senator Graham, first to you. It's been about 2 months since the U.S. First to protect U.S. interests in Iraq began airstrikes there. Is it too soon to tell whether there's been any success in at least containing ISIS in Iraq?
I'm sure there's been some. The idea of hitting them in Syria is long overdue because it makes it harder for them to reinforce Iraq. But this strategy of aerial bombardment is not going to work to destroy ISIL. And when General Allen, who I respect greatly, says it may be up to a year before the Iraqi army can try to retake Mosul, that's just unacceptable. The one thing I would tell you about these two segments, that the stronger Ebola gets in Africa, the more it spreads, the more entrenched it is, the more endangered we are. The same for radical Islam in the Mideast. It seems to be that the president is all in when it comes to Ebola. I want to compliment him for sending troops to help get ahead of this in Africa. But we've got a series of half measures with ISIL that are going to draw this conflict out and will not lead to the ISIL's destruction, which makes it much more dangerous for over here. You know, the stronger they get in the Mideast, the more danger we are here at home.
Senator, you know as well as anyone that conducting any kind of war, and conducting a war that includes U.S. ground troops, you cannot do without public support. As far as I can see in the polls, certainly there is support for what's going on now. But when it comes to ground troops, and we've now, I think, seen the first death when it comes to a U.S. Marine that was involved in some way in the fight against ISIS, there is not the public support there for another ground war where we already spent 8.5 years, and it's a mess.
Well, all I can tell you is that the job of the commander-in-chief is to protect the country. The job of House members and senators is to protect the country. And I think most Americans understand if we don't destroy ISIL, if they survive our best shot, that we're all less safe. And at the end of the day, you cannot destroy ISIL in Syria without a ground component. And what we're doing with the Free Syrian Army is militarily unsound. To train these young men up in Saudi Arabia without first establishing a no-fly zone to take Assad's air power off the table will lead to their slaughter. It is immoral. There is no way that I can see how we fix the problem in Iraq and Syria without American ground troops. This mythical Arab army that we're trying to get up to going on the ground in Syria will need a lot of American handholding. And if it takes a year before we can go to Mosul, I can only imagine how strong ISIL will be. So, Mr. President, level with the American people. You need boots on the ground, and these are human beings with hopes and dreams, not just boots. American soldiers need to go back to Syria and Iraq as part of a coalition, and we're going to need more than 4,000 to destroy ISIL
Senator,
in Iraq and Syria.
If I could, what can many thousand U.S. troops, along with coalition troops, do in the next year that 100,000 U.S. troops couldn't do in 8.5 years?
Well, we left Iraq in a good place. And to those who say that this was the Iraqis' decision to have no troops behind in 2011, I hope you'll read Panetta's book, listen to Ryan Crocker. President Obama made a fatal mistake. Iraq was in a good spot. He got to zero when it came to American troops because that's what he wanted. And he had a chance in 2012 to train the Free Syrian Army. He overruled his entire national security team. He got the results he wanted in Iraq, and that led to the rise of ISIL. This is not some tornado or hurricane that you can't control. His incompetent decisions in Syria and Iraq led to this problem. You can defeat ISIL. We must defeat ISIL, but it's going to require an American ground component, not the 82nd Airborne. It's going to require a coalition to go in on the ground, just not in the air.
But the question, Senator, is if we couldn't achieve security, if we couldn't train Iraqi troops to be up to snuff, then why can we do it now?
We did.
But if we did, then wasn't the president's decision okay? If Iraq was in a great spot, why argue that we should have stayed?
Every military commander said we needed between 10 and 20,000 troops. President Obama wanted zero. He said he promised to end the war. Well, what he did is he lost the war, and this has come back to haunt us. Hope the next president will understand. Listen to you, commanders. He had a chance in 2012 to train the Free Syrian Army. They were about to beat Assad. Hezbollah came in with Iranian help to turn the tide of battle. The Russians doubled down, and we abandoned the Free Syrian Army. And ISIL is a result of these two mistakes. We have to destroy ISIL. The president says they only understand the language of force. The president's right. Unfortunately for us, the language of force is the second language for President Obama. When he talks about what he won't do, that's all the terrorists hear. When he says there will be no ground component to go into Iraq and Syria, an American ground component, the terrorists understand what that means militarily. So this strategy to defeat ISIL has to have an American ground component. I am sorry it does. I'm sorry we've made mistakes. Bush made mistakes. He corrected. Obama's made mistakes. He needs to correct. But this strategy we have regarding the Free Syrian Army is going to get all these kids slaughtered if you don't deal with Assad's Air Force. We can win in Iraq. We can win in Syria. It's going to take commitment. It's going to take effort. And God help us all if we don't win.
Senator, quickly, just a couple of quick political questions. The first is, if Republicans should take over the U.S. Senate in the elections next month, what would you like to see prioritized?
Number one, to sit down with a guy like Jack Reed, who's going to win his election, a good man to replace sequestration. You just heard a segment about the spread of Ebola throughout Africa. We're cutting the CDC's budget, the NIH budget. We're taking the military budget under sequestration cuts down to the smallest army since 1940, the smallest navy since 1915. We're destroying the Intelligence Committee. I want to sit down with Senator McCain, Jack Reed, Dianne Feinstein, a coalition of the willing, to replace these defense and non-defense cuts that are destroying our ability to protect our country, do something like Simpson-Bowles, where Republicans have to give on revenue, close some tax deductions in the tax code, put the money into replacing sequestration, and some entitlement reform. And finally, I want any deal that involves the Iranian nuclear program, which is the biggest issue facing the world, whether or not we're going to control the Iranian nuclear ambitions, to come to the Congress for an up or down vote. I fear we're on track to have a North Korea deal where we allow enrichment. The only thing that protects a breakout for a nuclear weapon is the UN. That didn't work in North Korea. So any deal with Iran, Candy, should come to Congress for an up or down vote.
And what's this about you running for president?
I know what it's like to run for president. I'm running for the Senate. I know what it takes to put an organization together, to put the money together. I've been with Senator McCain twice in this endeavor. I am nowhere near there. I am all in running for the Senate. And in 2015, I want to work with Jack Reed to replace sequestration. And I want to make sure that the Iranian nuclear deal is a good deal before it becomes law.
Nicely punted, Senator. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
I appreciate your time.
Thank you.